So with that being said, and you knowing a little bit more about the history, I'd like to talk about the first panel, and it is the causes and consequences of the Sand Creek Massacre. First, as this panel will explore the historical perspective on the complex circumstances leading up to the unprovoked attack on November 29, 1864, and the equally complex consequences that irreversibly shaped the nation. Our first speaker is Dr. Gary Roberts, and he will speak on the causes of the Sand Creek Massacre with particular emphasis on the roles of Governor John Evans and Colonel John M. Shivington. So, Dr. Roberts.
Good morning. I began my quest to understand Sand Creek 50 years ago this fall in an undergraduate class on the Civil War and Reconstruction. I had no idea then that a half century later, it would still be the primary focus of my research. My exploration of Sand Creek began with a premise, and it was very simple, that searching for truth, the historian's role is not to care what the truth is. Father Francis Paul Prucker said, "We must be only concerned with finding it." For me, that means that my role is simply that of a searcher, seeking to supply enlightenment, understanding, and perspective, and to provide sound information upon which balanced judgments can be made. This perspective early on left me unhappy with the debate over Sand Creek. It is all about, or has been all about, justification and condemnation. Those who justified Sand Creek argued that the incident was a response to a bloody summer's war and that the soldiers were decent, hardworking men protecting their families and neighbors, so Sand Creek could not have been a massacre. Those who condemned Sand Creek made the case that it was a massacre, so the soldiers had to have been twisted or sick or mining camps trash. I wrestled with this for a time before seeing a common link between them. Both interpretations rested on the character of the attackers. They were good men, so it couldn't have been a massacre. Or Sand Creek was a massacre, so they couldn't have been good men. Both of these views offered comforting solutions to the moral dilemma posed by Sand Creek. The first by denying the massacre occurred at all, the second by dismissing it as the work of social outcasts. Both views vindicated, and some still try, to vindicate good men, uphold American values, and affirm traditional moral standards. Both are briefs concerned with making cases to support predetermined position. But what if Sand Creek was carried out by rational men with clear notions of right and wrong, by men with no perceptions of themselves as evil, by men who acted on what they believed to be true, by men who defended themselves afterwards because they believed that their intentions were right, even though they were responsible for one of the worst atrocities in American history? This notion frightened me. Here was a possibility far worse than passing Sand Creek off as the work of sociopaths or barroom scum. Here was a reminder that all human beings are capable of great evil, not just the deviants in our society. How could this be? The Euro-American world is prone to moralism, with an insistence that good and evil are opposites, so that the struggle is between what is right and what is wrong, what is good and what is evil, each sharply defined and separate. It's easy and comforting as a way of seeing, but consider an alternative view, which, by the way, is held by more than a few cultural groups, including at least some American Indians. In this view, humanity's worst instincts are held in check by a fragile tether within every person. Sometimes it snaps, and good men do horrible things. It may be argued, then, that the process that led Coloradans to the Little Dried River and all of the ways they rationalized what happened there revealed just how human they were. For me, that was more terrifying than the usual interpretations about good guys and bad guys. There's no doubt that Sand Creek was a massacre. Any interpretation that argues the contrary is rationalization. The violation of plighted faith is unmistakable. The slaughter of women and children is undeniable. The atrocities and mutilations of the dead are beyond dispute. Prisoners were systematically killed, and these excesses were celebrated both by the soldiers who committed them and by the community they represented. If the evidence of every source that denounced the attack is disallowed, the most damning evidence remains in the newspapers of the times and the reminiscences of those who praised Sand Creek, well summarized by the Central City Miners Register when it wrote, "The true policy is to give them no quarter, but to kill male and female, old and young, that none may be left to tell the tale." It was only later, after two congressional committees and a military commission investigated Sand Creek, that the history of the massacre began to be rewritten, atrocities denied, and rationalizations formulated to justify what happened. Frank Hall, who was part of the story, later wrote in his History of Colorado that the most damning aspects of Sand Creek were attacking a village under the protection of the flag and the failure to take prisoners. He wrote, "It was this more than any other stain attaching to the historic tragedy which brought the condemnation of mankind upon the leaders of that terrible day, and which, strive as we may to efface it, will remain the deliberate judgment of history." The atrocity, then, is plain. Less clear is how such a thing could happen. In searching for causes of the Sand Creek horror, it is easy enough to find hatred and prejudice and arrogance, but we can overlook the fear and the grief and the rage, the misguided sense of them and us, and the twisted sense of self-defense and community based upon a false understanding of the truth that sustains these sins. But remember, while truth is the ultimate goal, what men believe to be true is more important, because they act upon what they believe. Understanding what happens requires us to set aside our modern way of seeing and to seek to understand the mindset of the participants rather than to judge them by our own. Euro-Americans had a sense of cultural superiority so deeply embedded that it seemed not only self-evident but right. It was not just the worldview of bad guys. For 1,000 years and more, Europeans had embraced views that endorsed both a right of conquest and justification of the dispossession of indigenous people. The first began with a linear view of life and progress that gave superior rights to those more advanced, by their own definition, I should add. It was enhanced by the biblical admonition to multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. This right of conquest worked its way into the law and was accepted as truth. What rights smugly pointed to their religion, their science, their cities, and their literature to convince themselves that they were right. From the time of the Greeks, there was always a brutal other to be overcome, whether Persian, Gaul, Hun, Mongol, Pict, Viking, Saxon, Saracen, Scot, or Irishman, the savage other was always there, with cultures to be rooted out and land to be taken. Race came late to this rationale of conquest. Savagery was the obstacle to be overcome. In practically every environment, the options were those offered by General John Sullivan on the eve of his campaign against the Iroquois in 1779, civilization or death to all American savages. Ironically, the American ideals of freedom and democracy were forged against the backdrop of particularly brutal Indian warfare. Anti-Indian sentiment was unchallenged on the western fringes of settlement, and in a bold literature that depicted all Indians as merciless savages with brutal practices, including the torture of prisoners and the murder of noncombatants. This image took deep root in American consciousness and was still present a century later. There were dissenters who warned that generalization and prejudice would fix a stain on the national reputation of America. Despite efforts to restrain the process, and to be fair, well-meaning policymakers were incapable of restraining the flood of settlers into the West. They tried various approaches, but it was always easier to relocate Indians or to kill them than to expel white trespassers on the land. The goal of those who sympathized with the Indians was to make the process of dispossession less painful, not to end it altogether. Whether viewed as ruthless or noble, the savage was vanishing. White people saw the Indian as a single, backward culture destined to give way. When the first settlers reached Colorado, they did not know who the Cheyennes were, or the Arapahos, or the Utes, or the Kiowas, or the Sioux, but they knew the Indian. Dispossession accelerated after the Mexican War and the California Gold Rush as tens of thousands of settlers rushed westward. By the time of the Colorado Gold Rush and the Civil War, policymakers were practically unable to restrain the flow or to control interaction. The man chosen to manage Colorado's affairs was John Evans, who became governor and superintendent of Indian affairs in 1862. He was a physician, philanthropist, entrepreneur, a prominent layman in the Methodist Church, a man ambitious for public office, a model American. He also had a particular interest in railroads and a desire to make Denver the next great metropolis by building the transcontinental railroad through the heart of Cheyenne and Arapaho lands. He had no understanding of or sympathy for the tribes, never even questioning the treaty system itself. His contempt for the Cheyennes and Arapahos was plain. And after a feeble effort to treat with them in the fall of 1863, he proceeded with a plan to force all of the Cheyennes and Arapahos onto the Sand Creek Reserve created in 1861 by the Treaty of Fort Wise. It was passed to accommodate a few southern bands, but it was never intended to be binding on all Cheyennes and Arapahos. Evans worked to change that. His partner in Colorado was John Milton Shivington, the commander of the Military District of Colorado. Shivington was a former Methodist minister, a giant of a man with an undeniable charisma, who won a measure of glory against the Confederates at the Battle of Glorieta in 1862. His Methodist and Republican credentials made an alliance with Evans seem natural. But contrary to most accounts, their relationship was troubled from the beginning. Shivington was obsessed with promotion, transfer east to fight Confederates in the political future, and he did not see those things in campaigns against Indians. As Evans grew increasingly convinced that an Indian war was inevitable, Shivington played down the threat of the Cheyennes and Arapahos and insisted that he could handle the Indians and launch raids into Texas against Confederates as well. By midsummer of 1864, Shivington had diddled and dawdled and neglected his duties so blatantly that General Curtis, his commanding officer, removed a significant portion of his district and created the District of the Upper Arkansas. Even then, Shivington spent most of his time running for Congress, while a real Indian war developed on the Platte and Arkansas routes. Shivington was blistered in reports by other commanders, and eventually Shivington's effective fighting force was reduced from more than 3,000 men to little more than 600. Evans lost confidence in his partner as well. Although he continued to pressure Shivington, he bombarded General Curtis and Secretary of War Stanton with predictions of doom to the point that Curtis said, "Everything from Colorado is sensational." When a family was murdered near Denver in June, citizens were terrified. Evans issued a proclamation to the friendly Indians of the Plains, but before any group had time to reasonably respond, he issued a second proclamation authorizing settlers to find and kill hostile Indians and demanded permission from Washington to raise a 100-day regiment for the explicit purpose of fighting Indians, despite the fact that the major fighting came near the overland routes in Nebraska and Kansas. The primary effects in Colorado were to interrupt commerce and create hysteria in the mining camps. Shivington seemed to have lost control, and Evans seemed to have lost control, and Shivington declared martial law in Denver. Things careened downhill from there. Statehood was crushed at the polls as a party of Cheyenne and Arapaho chiefs were escorted to Denver to seek peace terms. Despite the governor's waffling and Shivington's tough talk, the chiefs left Denver convinced that terms had been reached to begin the peace process. The overland routes opened up and commerce resumed. General Patrick Connor showed up in Denver to seek Shivington's cooperation for a winter campaign against the tribes on the Republican and Smoky Hill Rivers. Evans was elated. Shivington was stunned. Shivington knew that any campaign under Connor would give him, not Shivington, the glory. Evans left for Washington shortly thereafter. En route, Evans visited General Curtis about another joint campaign against the tribes. In Chicago, he told a friend that all of the Indians in Colorado were hostile except for a band at Fort Lyon. On the other hand, Shivington was desperate. His term of service was due to expire. He had no stars on his uniform. He had no prospects of fighting Confederates. His bid for Congress had failed. He could not mount an effective campaign with the troops at his disposal. But Evans had left him a loaded gun, the 3rd Colorado Volunteer Cavalry. Shivington's one hope was a dramatic victory, but he did not have time for an extended campaign. It had to be quick and sure, and the only sure target was a gathering of Cheyennes and Arapahoes near Fort Lyon. Mobilizing the 100 Dazers and a few troops from the 1st, he marched on Sand Creek. So it came down to that. Governor Evans' mismanagement of Indian affairs that created a panic in the territory, and Shivington's ambition. The Sand Creek Massacre was the result. The men who followed Shivington and committed the atrocities were not unlike other men, except in their rationalization that the ends justified the means, their false sense of community, of us against them, their fears, their willingness to go along, and their ignorance of the true circumstances. The great victory was celebrated in Denver, and Shivington enjoyed the praise, but it was short-lived. Shivington's victory became his shame in the eyes of the country, and Evans rightly shared the blame, as did his men. Shivington had managed to offend the sensibilities of Americans locked in the bloodiest war in their history. Sand Creek became an emblem of failed Indian policy in the decades that followed. What the reformers could not do, however, was to break with their mindset enough to see any alternative but assimilation. And so once again, tribal interests were sacrificed on the altar of good intentions. Given the times and the attitudes, I do not know that it could have been otherwise. But to ignore the shared humanity of the conflict with easy labels merely rearranges the stereotypes and oversimplifies a cultural conflict that victimized the conquered and in a strange way the conquerors as well. Something central to the shared humanity of victims and victimizers was involved. And that something does not mean excusing the horrors or justifying wrong. It does mean exploring intent as well as outcome. It does mean looking at the chilling ways that good men lost their way in their treatment of others and denied reality and led generations, even the most recent ones, to deal with what happened in ways that rationalize rather than explain. So we're left in a terrible place, rightly outraged by what happened, but aware too that we are cut from the same human cloth as they. I have a deeper understanding of prejudice, fear, and character as a result of my studies. And I am more aware of the danger of the them and us worldview. Peace, not peace in the sense of the absence of conflict, but in the ancient sense of that wholeness and unity that is true good, is the outcome we should seek. That is a way that heals and makes right. That is a way of reconciliation that the old ones understood, and a truth that even a historian can care about. And so, with tears, I continue my search. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Roberts.